Hello everybody, my name is Keith McIntosh from PV Lighthouse, and together with my colleagues Malcolm Abbott and Ben Sudbury, we've put together a presentation on how the PVSyst inputs for bifacial systems depend on conditions. This work stems from a project we undertook last year with Array Technologies and CFE Laboratories, and so we gratefully acknowledge the help from Kumin Lee of Array Technologies for his contributions to deriving PVSyst inputs, and Jim Crimmins of CFV Laboratories, so for applying all of the system specifications from his test facility. We use those specifications throughout this work. We'd also like to thank the Bifi PV workshop organisers for putting together a great program and for inviting us to give this presentation. In this work, we restrict ourselves to simulating just the central modules of a large PV array, like this one. That simplifies the simulations, of course, which is a good place to start because it's still early days in our endeavours to calculate the best inputs for PVSyst. So let's investigate the gains and losses of a central module in a large PV array. We'll plot those losses in terms of the short circuit current, which is proportional to the intensity of light absorbed by the module. Now, in this first column of the graph, we're going to give the results for a perfect module, one that converts all incident photons into collected electrons, and we'll normalize it so that it adds up to one. Now, this is a specific example, and if you happen to be in Phoenix today, at roughly the time of this presentation, and out the window you can see a large tracking bifacial system that has the same dimensions as the CFE test facility, and the ground is covered in white rocks and it's sunny, then the numbers we present will be representative of a central module in that system. If you're anywhere else or if it's any other time, then the numbers we present won't be exactly representative of the modules you can see. But they will give you an idea of the relative importance of these various losses and gains, and also what can be quantified with our SunSolve simulator. In reality, not all of the photons that are incident to a module are transmitted into the silicon to generate current. Some fraction of them will be reflected, and that reflection will depend on the angle of incidence, as shown in the graph on the right. When we account for that, the short circuit current is reduced by 4.8%. Now, some fraction of those rays will be reflected from the glass of one module and onto another module, and thereby increase current. And so, in this case, we found that to be 0.2%. Modules aren't really a rectangular lump of highly absorbing material. Instead, they contain frames and they contain multiple cells, and the cells have spaces between them. Light can pass through the cells as well. They're not entirely absorbing. When we take all of that into account, we see a 20.1% reduction in the short circuit current. Not all photons that are absorbed by the silicon contribute to the short circuit current. We can account for that by multiplying the absorption by the collection efficiency. We can also take into account the light that falls between the modules within a row, the shading from the torque tube, and also the reflectance of light from the torque tube and up onto the cells. We can also take into account the wavelength dependence of the white rocks and use that instead of a weighted average for the albedo. And instead of using the AM1.5G spectrum, we can use a more realistic spectrum as calculated from the precipital water vapor and the air mass. Here we plot all of those results again, but this time with the y-axis going from 0 to 1. That gives you a better indication of the relative importance of front and rear illumination. As mentioned, it's solved for direct light. We also perform the same simulation under isotropic light. As can be seen in this graph, a greater fraction of the short circuit current arises due to rear illumination, and that's expected on a cloudy day. We also see that the various loss mechanisms are different under isotropic conditions as they are under direct light. In other words, as we go from a sunny to a cloudy day, the losses are different. That's also true when we change the albedo or when we change the location of the system. And so what's important for any simulation is that we're taking into account such losses accurately, one way or another. A final loss mechanism to mention is cell-to-cell mismatch. The figure on the left shows how the intensity falling on each cell of a module can change or be different, and that leads to differences in the current generated by each cell, And when the cells are strung, as they are in a module, in strings or parallel strings separated by pi-biased diodes, we can end up with a loss in power. In this case, under this example, we had a loss of 0.24%. The results we've presented so far were all determined with SunSolve, which uses ray tracing and spice modelling to take into account all of the effects we've discussed. SunSolve was found to agree closely with experimental data taken by CFE at their test facility in Albuquerque. And together with CFE and Array Technologies, we've presented those results before. Some of them are also contained in Kuman Lee's excellent presentation from yesterday, which I encourage you to download and enjoy. And so SunSolve provides an excellent reference point with which to determine PVSyst inputs. Many of you will be familiar with using PVSyst to simulate bifacial systems, and you'll recognize the screenshot on the right, which shows the principal bifacial inputs required for PVSyst. They include the transmission factor, the albedo, the structural shading from things like torque tubes, posts, clamps, the mismatch for the rear. There's also a value for the mismatch for the front, but that's predominantly it's dominated by module-to-module mismatch. And so in this work, we combine the two into a single mismatch value. And then there's the bifaciality of the modules. We can determine those PVSyst bifacial inputs using SunSolve. SunSolve uses ray tracing rather than a view factor model. To assess the various losses, we're solving those by including inputs such as the torque tube diameter or its reflectance, rather than a simple loss factor, as in PVSyst. And it solves the optics down to the cell level, which allows us to assess the cell-to-cell mismatch. It also accounts for wavelength dependencies. Now, this makes SunSolve more accurate, but it also means that it's slower. It requires a longer computation time. And, for example, to solve an annual yield in 1 hourly intervals, it currently takes about 5 minutes, as opposed to 10 seconds. It gives more detail on the differences between the two programs, but you'll need to press pause to have a chance to read them. Let's get back to simulating a central module in a large PV array. We'll take the weather for Phoenix. We take that from Media Norm and feed it into both programs. We generate spectra for both direct and diffused light for each hour of the day, and we feed those into SunSolve. We set the inputs for the system, such as the row pitch and module spacing, to have the same values that we'd used previously in our collaboration with CFE and Array. And notice in the bottom left-hand graph that the albedo is wavelength dependent, as is the reflectance of the galvanized torque tubes. And finally, the inputs to the module were chosen to replicate a modern 72-cell bifacial module. For PVSyst, we really only need the dimensions and the bifaciality, as well as the equivalent circuit inputs, which are the same for SunSolve and PVSyst. But for SunSolve, we need many other inputs, and we've deduced those over the years for different module types. In this case, we've done it for the 72-cell bifacial module, and we've ensured that the STC behavior of the module, as simulated by SunSolve, gives the same results under both front and rear illumination as the measurements on those same modules. We can now use SunSolve to determine the PVSyst bifacial inputs. Firstly, we set the transmission factor, FT, to zero, and that's because PVSyst treats the transmission as illuminating the ground uniformly, so it may as well be contributing to the albedo. We determine that albedo by simulating the system with the space between the modules, but without any structural shading, and we solve it for three different albedo values of 0, 100%, and the wavelength dependence reflectance of white rocks. When we combine those results, as shown in the equation, we can determine a logical approach to finding FA, the albedo factor. And when we solve the simulation with and without structural shading of the torque tube, we can determine FS, as shown. And finally, with a complete simulation, but solving with and without mismatch, we can determine the combined mismatch factor, one that's accounting for both front and rear illumination. But here, we scale it to make it consistent with the input value and the approach taken in PVSyst for rear mismatch. at least in the version of PVSyst we're using. Here are some results. Here we're plotting those three values, FM, FS, and FA, for every hour of the year. And we're plotting it against the direct fraction. That's going to be 0 on a fully cloudy day and 0.9 on a very sunny day. And we plot it against the solar zenith. And you can see that there's some trends, but most importantly, you see that there's a large degree of scatter. In other words, a single value of FA won't provide an accurate value for PVSyst at all data points, but we can still determine a power-weighted average that best fits a year, and that's what those lines represent. Also of interest is how those inputs might vary with season, and we plot that here in the graphs on the left. Each data point represents a day, and we can see in particular that the albedo factor varies from summer to winter. And we can summarize those bifacial PV inputs that we've determined with this table. Under calculated value is the power averaged or the power weighted average for each PVSyst input. On the right, we have a value we're going to call the traditional value. That is, if one didn't have SunSolve or some other sophisticated ray tracing software, how would we have estimated those inputs? For example, the albedo we would have measured with a thermopile. And the measurement at CFE gave a 30% albedo. But through this method, by accounting for spectrum, the thermopile, of course, integrates all wavelengths. But here we're most interested in wavelengths from 300 to 1200. We're accounting for different spectra and so on. We find that the albedo that leads to the best fit would be 26.5%. Structural shading is another one that's considerably different. By a traditional approach, we may have divided the width of the torque tube by the length of the module. And there, we would have come up with a 5.9% value for the structural shading, rather than the value we've found of 7.8%, which takes into more angles of incidence and the shadow of the torque tube on the module. Most significantly, the mismatch factor we've found, which combines both and is effectively the value that you would insert into for the rear in PVSyst, is only 2.8% as determined by SunSolve, but the default value is 10%. Let's put these results into context. In this example module, in our example system in Phoenix, we used SunSolve and found that the annual yield would be 1,023 kilowatt hours. When we use PVSyst, and when we use those inputs as determined from SunSolve for the bifacial values, FT, FA, FS, and FM, the output yield was 1,038 kilowatt hours. That's 1.3% higher. Taking those traditional approach to finding those inputs, it would have been higher still. This tells us that the calculated inputs are leading to a lower discrepancy between SunSolve and PVSyst, but it's still significant at 1.3%. So although we've found a methodical way to determine the inputs, we're still left with a significant difference that must relate to something like the variability in the spectrum, the difference in the ground illumination model, numerical errors, or differences in the equivalent circuit solving between the programs. It's also worth plotting the difference in the daily yield between the two programs, as shown in these figures. And you can see that over the course of the year, the difference varied from between 0 to 3%. And here we plot those results in terms of the difference in hourly yield. And we see there's a lot more scatter and that the standard deviation of that relative difference is 4%. We can consider that the RMSE. So we've brought the two programs as best we can into alignment by setting these inputs for PVSyst as determined from SunSolve. And now we're going to change the location. We test Chicago, Singapore, and Nairobi. We maintain the same albedo, but we change the weather file, and of course, we change the latitude and longitude. At first, we kept the same input values for FA, FS, and FM, ran the simulations, and we found that there was significant differences between the discrepancies between the programs. If instead we determine those three parameters separately at each location, we find that the albedo and the structural shading factors remain about the same, but the mismatch factor changes, and it increases slightly as we move to cloudier climates. More importantly, we find that we can reduce the discrepancy by a little, 0.2 to 0.3%, setting those values, but that the discrepancy remains quite different between location. In other words, whatever's causing that discrepancy is varying on with either the weather or the latitude. We then followed a similar procedure to evaluate what would happen when the albedo changed. In these results, we found that there was a significant and the greatest discrepancy between the programs for very high albedo. But that discrepancy could be decreased significantly by setting the three parameters by the method we determined. We find in that case that the mismatch factor is quite high, it's almost twice the value under snow as it is under the baseline albedo, and that there's also a greater shading fraction that's occurring. And therefore, even with the same torque tube size, we effectively have greater shading of the modules. When we changed the height of the modules, we found there was very little difference, and that the three bifacial inputs remain relatively constant. And now let's wrap up. It goes without saying that PVSyst simulations should be more accurate if they contained well-assigned inputs. In this presentation, we described a way to determine the bifacial inputs of PVSyst using ray tracing and spice modelling. The inputs that we determined were found to vary a little with albedo and to a lesser extent with the location and cloud, the direct fraction. But even using those calculated inputs, we found that there remained a 0.2 to 1.7% discrepancy between SunSolve, which used the ray tracing and spice modelling, and PVSyst. That was the discrepancy for the annual yield. It was even greater for the daily yield, where it went up to about 3% for our baseline case. The sources of these discrepancies remain to be determined. They probably relate to differences that the programs take in terms of spectral dependence, ground illumination, the incident angle modifier, and possibly due to numerical errors. We'll investigate those in the near future, and we hope to present those to you someday down the track. We thank you all for listening.